Hello and good day to all of you. So in this video lecture, we are going to learn about NMO, which is normal move out. DMO is a dip move out, and LMO is a linear move out, which are the corrections applied to the seismic data processing. So there are a lot of confusion in NMO, DMO and LMO, when we have to apply and how we have to apply and what are the effects of these corrections to the seismic data. So before starting the lecture, so we have some learning outcome for this piece of lecture. So the first learning outcome of this lecture is to understand the NMO and also the application of NMO corrections in seismic. And the second learning outcome of this lecture is to understand and learn the DMO, which is dip move out and linear move out concepts and general workflow for these corrections before migration. So let's look at the what is NMO, normal move out. So I will rather explain the NMO concept with the definition but using the figure. So let's say in a short record you have multiple receivers on the right side and you have the source here. So when the waves goes into the subsurface, reflect back to from the reflectors or the any layer in the subsurface and reach to the receiver. So this short record actually showing the source and receiver ray path and the reflection point and also the CMB, which is the common midpoint in the black dot, and the increase of the travel time with the offset. So let's say when the waves travels from here up to the subsurface reflector and reached the receiver. So when it reaching to the far receiver, so the travel time increase, which is called when the source and receiver distance increase. So this travel time is called normal move out effect. Obviously we don't have one shot, so we have multiple shot in a short record. So a seismic line is acquired by rolling in shot and receiver a certain distance forward. So like here, let's say the first shot was here, then the second shot. So the receivers also shift toward the right. So it's called roll in shot record. And this gives more than one trace with the same midpoint. So let's say if this is the midpoint, so for the previous short record, which is this one and this one, so the midpoint was here. But now for this source and this receiver, the midpoint comes to here. So it's mean we have two midpoint CMP at this location. So further to explain, actually when we are doing the NMO correction, so we use CMP gather. So how we extract the CMP gather from the shot record. So this is a way, let's say we have the first shot, second, third shot, and with respect to this, this is the CDP point and CMP point is at the surface, which is the middle of the source and receiver distance. In this case, we have this black line, black dots here. So for this source and receiver, this is the midpoint. Then this is source receiver, this is the second and the third one, so on. So this is the common midpoint. So with respect to this common midpoint, we have to sort all of our data. Okay, so now we look at the final aim of the NMO or the objective of NMO. So let's say, as I mentioned, we have the same CMP in here, but with respect to different source and receiver, we have the different travel time. So let's say in this case, the travel time starts from here to here. And when the fire is shot here and receive the signal, so you can see the original offset trace is like this one, which is this red color. But actually, we have to bring mathematically source and receiver to this point, which is this travel time. So this travel time is equal to this one, which is the blue trace on the right side. So NMO objective is to bring this event which is affected by this travel time because of the source and receiver distance to the zero offset. So this is the zero offset. So it means mathematically we have to bring these two source and receiver to this position and calculate the travel time at this point. So this will be the output of the NMO. So this will give you the actual reflection of the subsurface point. So before we doing any type of NMO corrections or any noise removal from the data, so prior to that, we have to understand the shot record. So the shot record, what does it tell and what are the events in the shot record? So this is an example of the shot record, which is from the land data from Alaska. Obviously, the courtesy goes to the SAG for this shot record. So if this is a shot record, so in this you can see this is a split spread shooting. So we have both side receivers and this shot is here at this point. So try to understand the events which has been recorded here in this shot record. So the first one, let's forget about this side. So we are working on this side because this is the other side. So this, the first one which is received to the receiver first, is actually the head wave. So the source and we have the receiver here. So these are called the head waves. And the second one, which is this red point. So these are the P waves, which are receiving at this point over here. Then the slightly, or you can call it orange color, which is actually the S waves, because P waves are faster than S waves are slower. So these are the S waves, which is reaching from source to receivers. Then now the main reflection, which we are interested in, is actually the reflection, which is represented in the blue color. So these blue reflections are actually your seismic reflection. And obviously there is some other type of waves, which is the surface waves, so which is represented in the red color, and the air wave, which is comes in this part of the section. So these are to understand the waves or the shot record, how many types of wave. So now if we look at these all waves, so actually for seismic data processing, we are interested in seismic reflection data. So we have to remove or we have to get rid of all the others type of noises, the waves, to improve the signal. So in this case, we consider the signal as a reflection waves. So now we are trying to apply the same, we are taking the same data, which is the shot record. So this is before NMO corrections and obviously other filters like the air waves, the ground rolls, these type of thing. But after we apply the NMO correction, so also the other removal of the noise, so you can see your events have been flattened in out. This is before NMO corrections and this is after. So also we have to apply the NMO stretch, which is normally 25% of NMO stretch. So if you followed my the previous lecture, so you can look at this figures. Let's say if we have this input data and this is the NMO corrected, so you can see the stretch of the velocity because for that purpose we have to apply different type of stretches, which is 50%, 100%. So this is 50 and this is 100%. So similarly, we have, this is another example. So let's say this is before NMO correction, this is after NMO correction, so we have to apply the NMO stretch like this. So similarly, what happens, so now look at again. So this one is your input data and this one is your NMO corrected, and this is after the stretch mute. Okay, so the second thing comes into our mind is a DMO. So NMO is very straightforward, that if you have the flat reflectors. So what happened when we have the dipping reflector like this? So in this case, let's say this is the red receiver and green receiver and green source over here. So you see, supposedly the midpoint CMP is here, but CDP is not exactly below the CMP. So in these type of cases, when the reflector is dipping and the midpoint, which is here, is not vertically above the reflection point, which is this one. So this compares, if we compare from the previous slides, so the NMO can handle these cases, but breakdown when multiple dips are present in the subsurface, because there is not only one reflector, there will be multiple dipping reflectors in the subsurface, so it will not be handling. So that's why we have to apply the DMO. So when it becomes more complicated, let's say these are the dipping reflector and you have this inclined structure like this one, so you will see a lot of problems appearing when we have these type of subsurface feature. So if you look at the NMO corrected trace, so which appears to be like this, but DMO, which is dip move out, so this will be looking at a zero offset like this one. So you see this one, green, the second green, third green, then blue is also sort of green, which is fourth, fifth one, sixth, and so on. So like this one, you will have the sink line structure for this reflections. Just to give you an idea, so how much time it takes to apply the NMO correction and also DMO corrections to the data. So obviously there are some other things as well, gain filter, but we are specifically looking at the NMO. So NMO takes, for a simple data, which take 22 seconds. But the DMO, which is quite complicated, which takes 2845 seconds. So it's actually in seconds. And if you look at the pre-stack migration, which take 5000 seconds. But post-stack, let's take. So it's mean the DMO is one of the highest taking computational power with respect to the time and also the power. So the third thing comes in, which is the linear move out. So linear move out is actually referred to the same term as the normal move out, because the normal move out deals with the horizontal or linear subsurface event. And obviously when we don't have these type of non-linear or the dipping events, then the subsurface data or the output, then we apply the DMO corrections to the data accordingly. So it should be clear that linear move out is a similar terms for normal move out. So this is an example which is we are using NMO correction. So this is actually the input data. So the red lines is actually I draw on this top of this. So just to let you know that the events are dipping like the hyperbolic move out. So this is the semblance plot and this is your CVS on the right side. So when we pick the velocity here like this one, so you can see your events are flattened out. So you can play with the velocity changes here to make your reflector flat. So this is before and this one is after. And I also have one more example, which is using the NMO and DMO. So in case of NMO correction, so you can see over here the velocity has been very drastically changes. So this section is before NMO corrections. So once we pick the velocity, which is actually associated with the fault event, so you can see the events which is on the top on the shallow layers has been flattening out, but if you look at the deep event, so still you can see the hyperbolic move out. But when we pick the velocity based on the associated with the sedimentary strata, so you see on the top it has been showing the hockey sticks, but on the below event, which has been flattening out. So in this case, because of the fault, so we have the drastically changes the velocity. So this is about the NMO. And now we look at the another example about the DMO. So this is the data which has the dip move out effect in this area. So this is before DMO correction. So when we pick the velocity based on the semblance, So this correction to the data set using the DMO correction, corrected velocity function, that is posted on the spectrum. So when we post the DMO velocity spectrum on this one, so you can see the events have been flattening out. So the conclusion of this lecture, so if you look at the general workflow of the output of the migration or something, so normally what we do, first we go for NMO correction, then if there is some dipping event, we go for DMO, then we do the stacking and go for post stack migration. So it's not the plus sign actually mean by followed by, so you have to go with this one and then this one. But I'm speaking, but obviously when we have the complex structure like subsolved, then this sequence might be breakdown and fails to give the good image, because based on that you have to design your own workflow. And in this case, we are compelled to do one grand process called pre-stack migration, which followed by this one. So in fact, if the DMO was originally invented to complete the falling equality under the mild subsurface condition, so when that's why we go for pre-stack migration. So if we have to get the pre-stack migration, so first thing is first, which is NMO correction. Then the second thing, which is the question mark, which was unknown, but it's turned out to be DMO correction, because the dynamic corrections are very important. Then we go for stacking, and then we go for post-stack migration. So in here, actually DMO actually is used worldwide, and these workflows are used every day in the seismic processing center throughout the world. So I hope you have learned something about this NMO, DMO and LMO corrections, and you have been clear out your mind with understanding these concepts. With that's all, thank you so much, and I hope you have enjoyed the lecture. I hope to see you in the next lecture. Thank you and have a good day.